In today's session, we are going to touch upon the effect of noise and interference on FM signals. Now, let us consider the effect of interference on FM systems. So we have a radio broadcast station which is projecting a direct link or transmitting a signal D of T on towards the antenna. The received signal at the output of antenna is R of T. We also have an interference node or the base station which is projecting an interference signal I of T onto the antenna. The total signal received at the antenna is desired signal D of T plus the interference signal I of T. Now, this kind of an environment can be observed if you are driving. For example, you have tuned to say 99 megahertz, but at the same time you are moving away from this base station and you are moving towards this base station. So you would be actually capturing both the signals. In our present discussion, we will reflect on the interference for such FM system. So the desired signal, let us assume it is simply a pure sinusoid, that is A cos omega CT. Whereas the interference signal is I. I is the amplitude of a sinusoid, cos omega C plus omega T. Right. So this is our interference signal. So this is very near to the omega is very near to omega C. So the received signal will be a combination of DT and IT, which is expressed over here. In the second equality, what we can do is we can expand this cos alpha plus beta. So this is equivalent to cos alpha cos beta minus sine alpha sine beta. So in the third equality, I have taken cos omega ct common, which is over here, and the leftover terms are a plus I cos omega t, which is over here, minus the third term would be appearing as is. Now from this received signal, we can detect our envelope as well as our phase phi of t, whereas the envelope is the coefficient of cos omega ct, which is simply a plus I cos omega ct cos omega t. If you take the square of this one, so this is expressed over here. Similarly, we have sine omega ct, and the coefficient of it is I sine omega t. So if you take the square of this one, it is appearing over here. So if you take the under root, then this is our envelope, the under root a square plus b square. Whereas the phase phi of t is simply tan inverse b by a. Remember, this discussion is to point out the effect of interference on FM system. We have a desired broadcast station and an interference broadcast station. So next, considering that you are in a region, you are receiving a stronger signal from your desired broadcast station as compared to a weak signal from an interference broadcast station. So the desired broadcast station could be very near to you, whereas the interference could be far from you. Under such conditions, the amplitude of interference should be much, much smaller than the amplitude of your desired signal. Then what we can do is the phase that we expressed previously over here, this can be simplified further under the assumption that the amplitude of desired signal is much, much greater than the amplitude of the interference signal. So that is expressed over here. It is simply I by a sine omega t. So this is coming from this equality that if you have tan inverse of x such that the value of x is much, much smaller than 1, which in our case, this would be valid if we meet this condition, that is I is much, much smaller than a. So then you would have simply tan inverse of x is equal to approximately equal to x. And this is expressed over here. I by a sine omega t. And since I is very small, so we have ignored this term. Now this phase phi of t directly relates to PM signal. So remember, you have cos omega CT plus KP sin omega T. So I by A would relate to our KP over here, the sensitivity parameter for the PM, and this is the sinusoid, sin omega T. But if you are interested in the frequency modulated signal, so what we would do is we would take the derivative of this phase phi of T, right, and insert it over here. We have cos omega CT plus I. The derivative of sine is cos, and then the argument will appear over here, that is omega by A cos omega T. So if you take the derivative of phi of T, you would achieve this expression. To shed some further insights, you can observe that both for PM and FM, you have the term I by A. Since we have a stronger desired signal with amplitude A as compared to a weak interference signal with amplitude I, so the desired station is going to effectively suppress the interference. This is a phenomenon that we call as the capture effect. Furthermore, for PM, the sensitivity parameter KP is independent of frequency, whereas for FM, it is dependent on frequency. For such, we have a plot in which on the y-axis we have interference, whereas on the x-axis we have simply frequency omega in radians per second. Omega D identifies radians per second at the destination. Since the sensitivity parameter of PM is independent of frequency omega, so you have this behavior. But at the same time, for FM, KF is dependent or linearly dependent on omega, so you have a linear behavior of frequency omega with respect to interference. So that's why you have this FM. In the meanwhile, we have also plotted another curve which relates to a preemphasis and deemphasis, PDE, an area that we would look into next. Regardless of FM or AM or the technology used, we know that noise power non-linearly increases with frequency. This is shown by this plot. So on the x-axis we have frequency, whereas on the y-axis we have attenuation. So the attenuation increases as the frequency increases. So this shows that at high frequencies, detection of signals is quite challenging. So for such, we have a technique which is called preemphasis and deemphasis. Thus, for such behavior, what we can do is we can enhance our transmitted signal for high frequencies initially and then transmit it. And then on the demodulator, we can use an appropriate low pass filter to normalize the enhancement done at the transmitter side. Now, specifically for the angle modulated systems, the same set of procedure is applied. Now consider that you have a signal to noise ratio at the output of a receiver. Now this can be improved if the level of modulation is boosted at the top end of the radio spectrum, that is at the transmitter. That means just before the transmitter, you implement a filter, which is a high pass filter, that passes the low frequency contents at unity gain, whereas it emphasizes the high frequency content such as this. Now on the receiver side, you would need a low pass filter that captures the low frequency content at unity gain, whereas amplifies with a negative gain for high frequencies. Now let us understand this with the help of a block diagram. So we have a modulated input signal initially. So what we do is we first pre-emphasize. That is, we amplify the high frequencies. This signal is expressed as MF of T. Finally, MF of T is sent over the air by means of a FM transmitter. Now the preemphasis filter is nothing but a high pass filter. One such high pass filter can be realized by means of a capacitor, resistor R1 and then a resistor in parallel R2. Such a filter has this transfer function, whereas its magnitude response shows F1 and F2, which are given by the time constants expressed over here. Now, in short, what we have done is we have amplified the high frequencies and retained the low frequencies. Now, the transmitted frequency modulated signal passes through a channel and is then received at the FM receiver. So once it receives, we need to engage the reverse mechanism. For that, we would use a low pass filter, which simply needs an R1 and C. It has this transfer function, whereas F1 is simply 1 over 2 tau R1 C. So in short, what it does is that all the frequencies which were pre-amplified is normalized by means of a de-emphasized filter. So as a summary, what we have done is we have amplified the high frequency content of the frequency signal and transmitted it over a channel and then de-amplified it at the receiver side, right? With de-amplification, not only the signal would be de-amplified, but also the noise would be de-amplified. So this would reflect positively on the received SNR. Now let us again use a simulation environment to get some further insights. In this Simulink environment, we would show the effect of noise on an FM broadcast system. Again, for reproducibility, all the elements represented here can be obtained using the browser. Right. Initially, we have a sound file that can be extracted using a multimedia file. Then this is passed through an FM broadcast baseband with these parameters. Then I have a summation block. This summation block is used to incorporate the effect of white noise. Remember, white noise is simply an IID and it has the same power across all frequencies. So next we have a broadcast receiver. So this has to be in par with our transmitter. The output is fed to an audio device. And for further analysis, the input is sent to matrix concatenate and the output of FM broadcast, which is a sound signal, this is also sent to this matrix, and then both of these are then fed to spectrum analyzer. Now let us run this experiment. Where the blue spectrum is for the input data of sound, whereas the yellow is the demodulated baseband signal. Note that there is some difference over here, which is actually quite small because this is in dBm, but anyways, the main sound or the acoustic content is actually in this range until 12 kilohertz. Now let us induce some noise and see its effect. Now this is the noise power now, which I have set as 0.01, and let us run the experiment again. Now the effect of noise is quite evident in the audio signal that you have received. Note that since we have applied an additive white Gaussian noise, that role of noise has almost contributed equally at all frequencies, right? So if this noise is a thermal noise, that is the noise because of the movement of electrons, so you would not be able to reject it. But if the noise is from the channel, we can pre-process and post-process the data to get better results.